And the problem right now is, I mean, we do have our veggies growing, as you can see, which is quite nice. I mean, we could probably make more veggie fields, but veggies are limited. So what you could do is you could make more chicken coops. The thing is, like, the chicken production or the egg production doesn't meet up with the actual eating of the people. So as you can see, I made like some more chickens back here to keep up with this. But we do have enough leather and hides, so we should be fine with this. Especially because we don't actually need leather and hides anymore that much. So what I could do is I could actually break down all the goateries here right now to replace them to chickeneries. Yeah. But we could also build more apple orchards. Again, they need 3 years to happen, and you can see like this is beautiful, this is working out. So after the third year, apples are
Today's story is about a guy named John who just wanted to go surfing, and he would get a chance to do that. However, when he was finally out on the water, something super rare and super horrible happened to him that actually kicked off a series of more rare and terrible things that all happened to John. I mean, this whole story is so outrageous that it just sounds totally made up. But I can promise you, it's not. But before we get into that story, if you're a fan of The Strange, Dark, and Mysterious delivered in story format, then you've come to the right place, because that's all we do, and we upload once a week. So if that's of interest to you, please offer to make the like button a friendship bracelet using those little beads with letters on them, but make sure you spell on their bracelet, "Nobody likes you," before you hand it over. Also, please subscribe to our channel and turn on all notifications so you don't miss any of our weekly uploads. Okay, let's get into today's story. On an April morning in 1993, a surfer named John Doyle was sitting on a surfboard out in the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of West Africa, just scanning the water, waiting for a wave. John was totally alone out here. There were no other surfers, nothing, and the only sign of human civilization anywhere was John's Land Rover, which was parked up on the sand on the beach. John was an American. He was from Colorado, and so his experience had always been, you know, lots of snow and mountains and trees, because that's Colorado. But now, here, off the coast of Africa, it was like a totally different planet. And in fact, today, John was really feeling that because the sun was so hot that day. It was over 95 degrees Fahrenheit, and he could actually feel his back starting to burn as he sat there, you know, waiting for the next wave. And so he told himself, actually, that he would just catch one more wave and then call it a day to avoid a sunburn. But as John continued to kind of scan out across the water waiting for this wave, he noticed about 20 meters away was a shark fin swimming in a circle, like stereotypical terrifying shark behavior. And so John is horrified, and he wants to get out of the water immediately, but he's far enough away from shore that if he jumped into the water to swim to shore, you know, he's going to be in the water with the shark thrashing around. He's just gonna attract the shark over to him. And so John decides his only hope here to escape the shark is actually just to surf in. That way he'll stay out of the water, it's much faster, he'll get to shore, the shark can't follow him there, it'll be fine. And so, trying to stay calm, John continued to keep his eye on the shark that was still 20 meters away, and he also really looked closely for any swell coming towards him that might be big enough to allow him to surf to shore. And thankfully, after only a couple of minutes, John did see a swell coming towards him that seemed like it would be perfect for a final wave. And so at this point, John is facing out to sea towards the swell, towards the shark that's still 20 meters away, and he turns himself around, so he's facing towards shore, and then he lays down on his stomach, and he begins to paddle towards shore. And as he's doing this, you know, he's checking the swell to see when it's gonna come up, when he can stand up, and eventually the swell is right underneath him, and as he's about to stand up on his board and actually surf into shore, he looks into the water that has not quite formed into a wave yet, and he sees the shark. It's literally underneath him. And so John has this sudden surge of adrenaline, and he just jumps up onto his board. He stands up, and for a second, he's stable. He's surfing, and he's riding this wave away from the shark. He's doing exactly what he hoped he could do. He can't believe it. And then, because he was panicked, because he was rushing, because it was a new board, who knows why, the nose of his board suddenly dipped just long enough to throw John off his board and into the water with the shark. And so immediately, as this wave is churning John over, he grabs onto his surfboard and just kind of holds on, and he's waiting for a moment when the wave stops so he can get out of the water, back on his board, and away from the shark. But before the wave even stopped tumbling him over, John suddenly felt the searing pain in his calf. And so John, who's underwater, still clutching his board, he opens his eyes underwater and he looks down, and through the cloudy water, he can see very clearly it is the shark, and it's a great white shark that is latched on to his leg. And so now, in a total panic, John began punching the nose of the shark. And when he did, the shark actually recoiled and released his leg long enough that John could pull it out. He actually managed to get up onto his board again. And just a second later, almost out of instinct, he was back standing on his board, just surfing along with a leg that was now bleeding profusely into the water. And for a second, John was stable and appeared to be kind of moving towards shore again, but then the shark, it doubled around and swam at John from the side and literally smashed into him, knocking him off the board back into the water. But this time, John managed, when he fell the second time, to actually grab on to the board with both hands. So he has two hands on the board. He's getting tumbled in the water again, but he knows the shark is going to come for him. And so at the last second, he pulled the board close to his body and kind of turned himself like it was a shield. And the shark came flying towards him and bit him. But because he used that surfboard as a shield, the shark just bit the surfboard, ripped off half of it, and swam off with it and began mauling this half of the surfboard. And John, with the other half of the surfboard, he somehow managed to stand up on it. Again, his leg is bleeding everywhere, and he rode this damaged half surfboard into shore successfully away from the shark. And so when John pulled himself up onto the sand, you know, out of the water, he looked back and he saw the shark swimming off. And even though he's in excruciating pain from this attack, he was so relieved. He couldn't believe he actually just survived that. But John did not have time to think about, you know, what good fortune this was in a way, because he was an hour away from the nearest civilization. And between where he was now and that town, there was nothing. There weren't homes, there weren't buildings, there weren't offices, nothing. It was just totally wildlands until you got to that town. And so John knew he would need to get in his car and drive all the way to that town and then get the people of the town to go get medical help. So, I mean, he is hours away from getting the help he needs. And so he has no time to waste. And so he crawls through the sand. You know, his leg is killing him, but he's just so focused on getting up to his Land Rover. And he manages to get to his car. He opens the door. He climbs in the driver's seat. And then as soon as he's in there, you know, he shuts and locks the doors. And then he grabs a white t-shirt that he had on the passenger seat, and he ripped it into strips. And he used those strips like tourniquets, and he wrapped them around his leg. The leg was bleeding from his calf. And he basically used this tourniquet to attempt to cut off blood flow to his entire right leg to stop the bleeding, to save his life. But the wound on his right leg was so bad and so deep that despite putting on multiple very tight tourniquets, it just wasn't doing very much. He was still losing blood at a pace that likely would kill him before he got to town. And so John was kind of like, well, nothing else I can do but attempt to go to town. So he fired up his car, he reversed off the beach, and began making his way towards town.
我的后援农村乡地基金。当妈妈的第一天到每一天。
As John sped along the road, he began to feel very lightheaded. You know, between the pain in his leg and the extreme heat outside, he just felt very dehydrated and weak. And so he thought to himself, if I can't get a sip of water soon, I'm going to pass out right now, and then I'm done for. And so as he's driving along, John began fumbling around his car, you know, looking for any sort of liquid somewhere in the car. But ultimately, all he found was an empty water bottle. and all he saw in every direction was just this barren African savanna with no people and no water anywhere. And so John just kept on driving, hoping eventually he might find some water source. And luckily, after only a couple of minutes, when his eyelids were really starting to droop and he was having a hard time focusing, he noticed